Dear friends, I am Dr. K. Kannan, Professor Mechanical Engineering, Anjaliyammal Mahalingam Engineering College, Kolvinni. I am happy to meet you again through the video lecture series on the subject Engineering Thermodynamics. This is module number 3, Second Law of Thermodynamics. The topic of discussion in the module number 3 is Second Law of Thermodynamics. And this is the second lecture on the module 3. So, we recap from the previous lecture. So, lecture number 301, we studied about the heat engine and the heat engine cycle efficiency, and we have seen the two statements of second law of thermodynamics, Kelvin-Planck statement and the Clausius statement, and we discuss about the refrigerator, heat pump, and the COP calculation of refrigerator and the heat pump. And in this lecture, so we will be discussing about the equivalence of Kelvin-Planck and Clausius statements. So, there are two statements for second law of thermodynamics. We have to prove that the two statements are equal, and we discuss about the reversibility and irreversibility of a process, types of irreversibility, causes of irreversibility, and the condition for reversibility of a process. And the learning outcome for the lecture. At the end of the lecture, the student will be able to explain the equivalence of Kelvin-Planck and the Clausius statement, and the student will be able to define reversible and irreversible processes, and the student will be able to explain the causes of irreversibility, and also the student will be able to discuss the condition for irreversibility of a process. So, first we will take the equivalence of Kelvin-Planck and Clausius statements. So, though there are two statements for the second law of thermodynamics, Kelvin-Planck statement and the Clausius statement, and the two statements are equal. We have to prove that the two statements are equal. So, Kelvin-Planck statement says that, so for any cyclic device, cyclic engine, it is impossible to produce net to work for a cyclic engine to produce net to work with interacting with a single heat source. If you look at the heat engine or a heat pump or a refrigerator, the device is interacting with the two reservoirs. One is at the higher temperature and one is at the lower temperature. And the Kelvin-Planck statement says that it is impossible for any device to produce net to work by interacting with the heat reservoir at a single fixed temperature. And the Clausius statement that says that it is impossible to for any device to transfer heat energy from a low temperature body to a high temperature body without any additional effort. So, these are all the two statements, and we will prove that the two statements are equal. So, there is no direct method to prove the equivalence of the two statements. We use the indirect method. So, what is the indirect method? First, we assume heat engine which violates the Clausius statements also violating the Kelvin-Planck statement. So, you have to take a heat engine which is violating the Clausius statement also violating the Kelvin-Planck statement. So, when these two, when we prove this, that means Kelvin-Planck statement is equal to the Clausius statement. And we take this arrangement, we have a diagram here, and first we take the heat pump. So, what is heat pump? It is the heat pump and the heat engine both are interacting with the two reservoir. One is at the hot reservoir at a temperature small T1 and the cold reservoir with the temperature T2. First, we take the heat pump. So, the heat pump is taking heat energy from the cold reservoir and supplying heat energy to the hot reservoir. So, this is Q2. So, the amount of heat taken here is Q2 and it is supplying heat energy to the hot reservoir, which is Q1. Without any work input. So, what is actually a heat pump? A heat pump is a device which is extracting heat from your low temperature body and supplying heat to your high temperature body with some work input. So, when there is no work input and this heat pump is violating the Clausius statement. So, Clausius statement says that without any effort, without any external effort, it is difficult to transfer, it is not possible to transfer heat energy from a cold reservoir to a hot reservoir. So, this is violating the Clausius statement. Now we take the heat engine. So this is also operating with the same resources. So it is taking heat energy from a hot source. Q1 is the amount of heat energy given to the heat engine. It is producing work output from the heat engine, net work output, and the rejecting heat energy Q2 to the cold reservoir. So the heat engine taking Q1 and rejecting Q2 and producing net work, and this is the heat engine. Now the amount of heat given out by the heat pump is equal to amount of heat given to the heat engine. So the Q1, these two are equal. Amount of heat rejected from the heat pump or given out by the heat pump is equal to the amount of heat given to the heat engine. Now what we can do, we can supply the heat output of the heat pump to the input of the heat engine. So when you do this, we can remove the hot reservoir. So the heat output of the heat pump is given to the heat input of the heat engine. So we can eliminate the hot reservoir. So when you eliminate the hot reservoir, now look at the system. The system is a cyclic heat engine. It is producing net work by exchanging heat with a cold reservoir only, and there is no hot reservoir. So this is violating the Kelvin Planck statement. So initially we assumed that the heat pump is violating the Clausius statement. Then we defined the heat engine cycle. So the heat input to the heat engine is the equal to heat output of the heat pump, and these two are connected. When these two are connected, the entire system, neglecting the hot reservoir, the entire system is a cyclic heat engine producing net work with interacting with the cold reservoir. So this is violating the Kelvin Planck statement. So this is the first proof. Second proof, we take the heat engine which violates the Kelvin Planck statement, also violating the Clausius statement. So here again we take the two reservoir, the hot reservoir temperature T1 and the cold reservoir temperature T2. Now we take the heat engine which is PMM2, perpetual motion machine of the second kind. So this is not possible, this is violating the Kelvin Planck statement. So PMM2 is here. It is taking heat energy Q1 and producing work W without rejecting any heat energy. So it is not interacting with the cold reservoir. So this heat engine is violating the Kelvin Planck statement. Now we take the heat pump. It is taking heat energy from the cold reservoir and supplying heat energy to the hot reservoir, and the work given to the heat pump. Now the work output of the heat engine, which is Q1, it is given to the heat pump. So work output is given to, so this heat, what is given to the heat engine, it is given to the heat pump. So now this entire system, it is taking heat energy from the low temperature body and supplying heat to the high temperature body without any external work input. So this is violating the Clausius statement. So the heat engine, which is violating the Kelvin Planck statement, So it is also violating the Clausius statement. So this is how we prove the equivalence of Kelvin Planck and Clausius statement. And the second law of thermodynamics, which helps us to divide all the thermodynamic processes into two classes. One is reversible or ideal process, and another one is irreversible or natural process. What is reversible process? A reversible process is carried out infinitely slowly with an infinitesimal gradient, so that every state passed through by a system is in equilibrium state. So in the first unit, we studied about the quasi-static process. So the quasi-static process is infinitely slow process, very, very slow process. Each point in the cycle, each point in the path is in equilibrium condition. So such a process is called as reversible process. So for reversible process, the process should be carried out very slowly, and each point between A and B, it is equilibrium point, equilibrium state. And the gradient, what is gradient? dy by dx is the gradient. The change in y with respect to x is the gradient, and it is infinitesimal gradient. Infinitesimal means very, very small gradient. So, the the change in the parameter, one parameter with respect to another parameter is very, very, very small. That is what called as infinitesimal gradient. So, that such a process is called as reversible process. Natural processes are carried out with the finite gradient is an irreversible process. So, all the process in nature, all the actual processes in thermodynamics or thermal engineering, they are carried out with a finite gradient. It is an irreversible process. What do you mean by finite gradient? So, for example, you take a cup of coffee with some 50 degree or 60 degree Celsius. You keep the coffee on the table. So, the atmosphere is at 30 degree, 35 degree Celsius. So, because of the temperature difference, so there is a finite temperature difference, 50 degree minus 35 degree, 15 degree Celsius is the temperature difference. So, that is what the temperature difference, that is a driving force for cooling the coffee. So, that kind of process, natural process, all the natural process, they are irreversible. So, reversible process, they are hypothetical, and spontaneous process are irreversible. So, all the reversible process are hypothetical, that is theoretical. Practically, there is no reversible process. All the spontaneous process occurring in nature, they are irreversible. So, types of irreversibility, there are different types of irreversibility. One is internal irreversibility and external irreversibility. Internal irreversibility is caused by an internal dissipative effect like friction, turbulence, electrical resistance, magnetic hysteresis, etc. within the system. So, the friction, turbulence, electrical resistance, they are occurring within the system, that is called as internal irreversibility. External irreversibility, they refers to the irreversibility occurring at the system boundary like a heat interaction with the surrounding due to finite temperature gradient. So, when something is happening across the boundary of the system, so because of that, there is irreversibility, that is called as external irreversibility. The example is the finite temperature gradient across the boundary of the system. There is another way of classifying the irreversibility, mechanical irreversibility, thermal irreversibility and chemical irreversibility. So, mechanical irreversibility, the irreversibility of a process is due to the dissipation of work into increase in internal energy or due to finite pressure gradient. So, when there is pressure gradient across the boundary of the system that causes the irreversibility, that type of irreversibility is called as mechanical irreversibility. So, the force difference between across the boundary of the system or force difference within the boundary of the system, that is called as mechanical irreversibility. Thermal irreversibility, the process occur due to the finite temperature difference across the boundary of the system. And chemical irreversibility, the process occurs due to the chemical reaction or finite concentration gradient. When there is chemical reaction within the boundary or when there is finite concentration gradient within the boundary, that causes the chemical irreversibility. So, internal irreversibility, external irreversibility, mechanical irreversibility, thermal irreversibility and chemical irreversibility. These are all the different types of irreversibilities. And causes of irreversibility. So, the irreversibility due to lack of equilibrium, that is due to further divided into heat transfer through finite temperature difference, lack of pressure equilibrium within the interior of the system or free expansion. So, this is the first classification. Second classification, irreversibility due to dissipative effect like friction, pedal wheel work transfer, transfer of electricity through the resistor. So, there are two types of causes. It is due to irreversibility due to lack of equilibrium or irreversibility due to dissipative effect. Among all the, there are six different types of reasons for the irreversibility of any thermodynamic process, right? So, the major problem is friction. So, in any thermodynamic process, when the friction, it causes the irreversibility of a process. So, major cause is only the friction. So the first classification, first reason, heat transfer through finite temperature difference. Heat transfer process will be reversible when the heat is transferred through an infinitesimal temperature difference. I already told you infinitesimal means very, very small. So when there is, during the heat transfer process, when the temperature difference is very, very small, then the process is called as, then the process will be reversible process. The transfer of finite amount of heat through infinitesimal temperature difference will require infinite amount of time and infinite area. So, through small temperature difference, when the heat is transferred, a finite amount of heat is transferred, then the process will take very long time and it will take infinite area. So, but the actual heat transfer process through finite temperature difference and therefore they are irreversible. So the actual temperature difference, actual heat transfer process are through finite temperature difference. So therefore they are irreversible. Any actual heat transfer, as I told, cooling of a coffee, cooking in the kitchen, all these things are with the finite temperature difference. All the processes are irreversible processes. All the practical heat transfer processes are irreversible. So we have to prove that. We have to prove that the heat transfer with the finite temperature difference is irreversible. So you take a source A and a sink B with TA temperature here and TB is the temperature here. Now there is a heat transfer process. Heat is transferred from the source A to the sink B. The amount of heat transfer equal to QA minus B. Now here we have a heat engine, another heat engine. It is independently working here. So, Q1 is the amount of heat energy given to the heat engine and it is producing net work, and the Q2 is the amount of heat rejected. So, this is the heat transfer and the heat engine, they are independently working. And now, we have to prove that the reverse of the heat transfer process is not possible. So, the heat transfer with the finite temperature difference is not possible. Now, we take the heat engine. So, the heat engine is working here. Now, we try to reverse the heat transfer from the cold temperature to the low temperature to high temperature from, now the heat transfer is QBA. Now, so heat from here, from the sink, it is given, transferred to the source. Now, what we do? We connect the output of the heat engine to the input of the heat transfer process. So, when you connect these two, because here, from here, the heat is transferred to the source. So, Q2 is connected here, and by connecting Q2 and the QBA, we can remove the heat sink. When you remove the heat sink, and this is violating the Kelvin-Planck statement, because there is a heat engine producing net work by interacting with a single reservoir, because sink is removed, single reservoir, and this is violating the Kelvin-Planck statement. So, the heat transfer with a finite temperature difference, it cannot be reversible. So, it is an irreversible process. So, QAB is the heat transfer with the finite temperature difference. So, QBA is not possible. That is what we are trying to prove here. And when there is heat transfer through finite temperature difference, the process is called as irreversible process. Lack of pressure equilibrium within the interior of the system or between system and the surrounding. So, when there is pressure difference within the system or between the system and the surrounding, the system will undergo a change of state to establish mechanical equilibrium. The reverse of the process is not possible. That is what the irreversible process. So, lack of pressure equilibrium within the system or between the system and the surrounding, they are irreversible. And the free expansion. So, what is free expansion? So, it is a process. So, we have a insulated chamber, insulated vessel, and the vessel has got the two chamber. So, the chamber, they are separated by a diaphragm. Chamber A is filled with some gas and chamber B is completely vacuum. Now, you puncture the diaphragm. Now, the gas will freely expand and occupy the entire vessel. It occupy B also. So, during this process, there is no work done. And there is no heat transfer. So, compartment A contains mass of the gas, while compartment B is completely evacuated. If the diaphragm is punctured, the gas A will expand into the B until the pressures in A and B becomes equal. This is known as free expansion or unrestrained expansion. The reverse of the process without any external effort is not possible. So, we cannot bring the gas in the vacuum chamber to the A without any effort. That is not possible. So, free expansion is an irreversible process. And friction is another reason for irreversibility of a process. So, mechanical friction. So, you look at, assume a flywheel and you apply the moving brake block. When you move the block, the flywheel will be stopped. This is the system boundary. When you apply the brake, the wheel will be stopped and there is heat dissipation, right? So, friction is always present in the moving device. So, in any moving device, there will be friction. Friction may be reduced by suitable lubrication, but it can never be completely eliminated. So, we cannot completely eliminate the friction. By lubrication, we can minimize the friction. The continual motion of movable device in the complete absence of friction is known as perpetual motion machine of third kind. So, the machine without any friction, in the absence of the friction, is called as perpetual motion machine of third kind, which is not possible. So, when there is a moving device, when there is a moving wheel or any rotating or reciprocating system, there will be friction. When the brake is applied, work done is zero and there is negligible heat dissipation. So, Q12 equal W12 equal to zero. So, when there is friction, that is irreversible. The process is irreversible. And pedal wheel work transfer. So, work may be transferred to an insulated chamber by means of pedal wheel, which is known as stirring work. So, this is what the insulated chamber, we have gas inside and using the stirring wheel, we are doing the work to the system. So, because of the stirring, the molecular internal energy of the system will increase. So, the work is transferred, work is transferred causes increases in the molecular internal energy of the system. Now we get the work output from the system. So, we extract the work output from the work is delivered by the system by decreasing molecular internal energy. So, when the work is done by the system, there will be decrease in the molecular internal energy of the gases inside the chamber, and the chamber is completely adiabatic, it is insulated, so it is adiabatic chamber. And the equal amount of heat is supplied from the heat source constitute the heat engine cycle. So, now we assume that, so the whatever the amount of work done by the gas, by the system, equal amount of heat is given to the system. So, there is work done and there is heat supply. It violates the Kelvin-Planck statement of the second law. So, that is, it constitutes the heat engine. It is producing net work with a single heat source. So, this is violating the Kelvin-Planck statement and PMM2. So, it is irreversible. So, pedal work, again, it is irreversible process. So, it violates the Kelvin-Planck statement of second law, producing net work by exchanging heat with a single reservoir becomes PMM2. So, it is irreversible. So, when there is pedal work in the thermodynamic system, that is also irreversible process. And the transfer of electricity through resistor. So, you just assume that there is current flow through a resistor. So, the current flow is called as work done. And this work and this current flow, it may be used for raising some weight or doing some work. Because of the resistance, there will be heat dissipation. The flow of electric current through a wire represents work transfer. Because the current can drive a motor which can raise a weight. Writing the first law of thermodynamics, Q12 equal W12 plus U2 minus U1, both Q12 and W12 are negligible because heat is rejected and work is given to the system. So, work is given to the system is negative, heat rejected from the system is also negative. At the steady state operation, temperature is constant, so U1 equal to U2. So, therefore, W1 equal to W2, the reverse of the process is not possible. What is reverse of the process? When there is current flow through the resistor, the heat is dissipated. When you supply the heat energy, we cannot produce the heat, we cannot produce the work in the resistor. So, reverse of the process is not possible. So, transfer of electricity through a resistor is also an irreversible process. Now, we discuss five different causes of irreversibility. That is we come here. Once again, I want to remind you, these are all the 6 different causes of irreversibility. What we discussed, heat transfer through finite temperature difference, lack of pressure equilibrium within the interior of the system, free expansion, friction, pedal wheel work transfer, transfer of electricity through a resistor. Among all the 6 different causes of irreversibility, in mechanical, particularly thermal engineering or thermodynamics heat engine, the friction is the main cause for irreversibility of a process. So, we have to be very careful with the friction. All the irreversibility in mechanical engineering, thermal engineering is due to the friction. And condition for reversibility of a process. A natural process is irreversible because the condition for mechanical, chemical, thermal equilibrium are not satisfied and the presence of dissipative effect. All the natural processes are irreversible. The process will be reversible when the process is performed quasi-statically. What is quasi-static? Very, very slowly. The system passes through states of thermodynamic equilibrium and there is no dissipative effect. When these three conditions are satisfied, the process will be reversible. So, the process performed quasi-statically, the system passes through state of thermodynamic equilibrium and there is no dissipative effect. So, when the three conditions are satisfied, the process will be reversible. So, we stop here. We have a reflection part. So, write down the terms that you remember from the previous discussion. So, in the previous 25 minutes discussion, what are all the points you remember? You take a paper, piece of paper and write the points, topics which are all remember, which you remember from the discussion. So, if you are able to write all these points, you are you have observed the lecture well. Heat engine, heat pump, reversible process, ideal process, irreversible process, natural process, internal irreversibility, external irreversibility, free expansion, friction, pedal work, electrical resistor, mechanical irreversibility, chemical irreversibility, thermal irreversibility. So, all these things you have to write. Then when you write all these points, immediately when you write a heat pump, immediately the working of the heat pump will reflect in your mind. When you write the free expansion, the free expansion process will reflect in your mind. When you write friction, the friction will reflect in your mind. So, this is one way of recollecting our thought, recollecting our memory. So, these are all the reference books I used for preparing the slides. You can also refer to it for additional information. And this is my mail ID. You can write to my mail ID for any clarification. So, thank you for watching and we'll meet again.